Many thanks for the very kind introduction there. Always like to have those. Ladies and gentlemen, I have been asked to discuss with you the perfect system, the perfect procurement system that cannot be challenged, that is litigation proof, that is essentially perfect. Now, that is some task, ladies and gentlemen. You'll understand to do that in 25 minutes is quite difficult. But I'll do so, and in doing so, I'd like to say that I feel a bit, and I hope you don't mind, I feel a bit like King Arthur and his knights of the Round Table. Do you remember them?
Arthur, King of the Britons, your knights of the Round Table shall have a task to make them an example in these dark times.
Good idea, O Lord.
Of course it's a good idea! Behold, Arthur, this is the Holy Grail. Look well, Arthur, for it is your sacred task to seek this grail. That is your purpose, Arthur. The quest for the Holy Grail.
Ladies and gentlemen, instead of the Holy Grail, my quest is the quest of the perfect evaluation and award public procurement system. I have often, very often, thought of what would be the ideal public procurement system, what would it look like, and I've come to the conclusions, ladies and gentlemen, there is not one perfect system. There are as many perfect systems as there are contracting authorities, because a perfect system must wrap around, must effectively fit perfectly for the contracting authorities' need. The use of standard forms are not to be followed, ladies and gentlemen. That is my opinion. I do not believe that any form, any template is a safe harbor for you. That is the wrong system to go to. If you do, you have to, and again, that is my advice to you, you should amend them to make sure that they fit your needs. There is, however, one simple pointer I can help you with. Let's call it the public procurement compass, the part that you should follow in order to avoid litigation as such, the straight line that you need to follow. And it is said that the distance in between two points is a straight line. But as a wise carryman once told me, there is no road without a bend, and a bend in the road is not the end of it unless you obviously fail to make the turn. For all those of you involved in public procurement, you know very well that public procurement journeys always come with a slew of uncontrollable factors, and only the strongest will, the keenest experience, and a sharp intuition can actually overcome those factors. But this requires an ability to judge what is right and wrong, and act accordingly, and to have this procurement compass. Now, the ability comes with experience. That will take time, but I will give you the compass. So, ladies and gentlemen, here it is. My compass for you is Article 18.1 of the Directive 2014/24, the same in the Utilities Directive. That is your magnetic north. That is what you have to follow. And believe me, there is not always a straight line, but that doesn't matter as long as it is the right line that you take. We're not looking for perfection. What does Article 18.1 actually tells you? It's very simple. You, the contracting authority, you shall treat economic operators equally and without discrimination, and you shall act in a transparent and a proportionate matter. Now, that's your compass, ladies and gentlemen, and with this, you have everything you need to know if you understand what those magical words mean. Now, an economic operator, what is that? Who is that? Well, that is your reasonably well-informed and normally diligent tender, which we refer to as the rewind, But it's not only rewind, it's rewind in the industry concerned. And I'll come back to that, and you will hear me saying that many times. It's the one in the industry concerned. Mr. Justice McCloskey, in the Northern Irish High Court case called Clinton case, in the Clinton case, he made it very clear that the rewind is a terrestrial being. He is not a celestial being. He is not hailing from Earth. Sorry, he is hailing from Earth, but not hailing from heaven. In other words, he is not a lawyer. It is settled case law that the way you interpret tender documents, the way you interpret the reasons given, the way you interpret the scoring matrix needs to meet the rewind tender. And the interpretation of all of those, and again, that is accepted, and you need to work on that basis, is it's not an exercise of a statutory construction. It is also, it does not involve any skills of lawyers to interpret a deed of a contract or any other legal instrument. Au contraire, says the court, rather than doing that, the focus must be on the industry concerned. So we have it again, the industry concerned, in which professionals and practitioners, but not lawyers, exist. And the test is, how would such documents be interpreted by these practitioners and in the industry concerned? That is what the court tells us. What follows naturally from the rewind tender is that the court will, as far as reasonable practicable, put itself, substitute itself into the position of the rewind tenderer to understand the technical terms, but also the context in which the documents must be construed. As Mr. Justice David Barneville tells us very clearly, the question is not, what did the ITT mean or meant? No. The question is whether its meaning could be clear or would be clear to the rewind tenderer and is equally suitable for objective determination. So when it comes to rewind, it is important to remember subject matter of the competition. I find it a very important element which is often forgotten. When you draft it, keep that in mind. The context you're in when you're drafting tender documents, keep in mind what your context is, and the industry concerned have direct implications on the way the interpretation is of tender documents. If you fail to interpret the award criteria as a rewind would have interpreted it in the test I've just given you, if you fail to do so, you breach the fundamental principle of public procurement, and you as a contracting authority have no margin whatsoever for this evaluation error, and the court will act and quash your decision. So make sure that you know who the rewind is when you go further. We're also told, very importantly, that we need to treat our tenderers equally. Now, a few little topics on that. The first one is, and the most basic one of the eldest public procurement cases, which is the Strobalt case. It states that observance of the principle of equal treatment of tenderer requires that all tenderers comply with the tender conditions. And that is so to ensure objective comparison of tenders. So the very first thing you have to always make sure is that your tenderers comply with the rules you have set out. And you should not be too quick to forgive someone for not having complied with, because that is a fundamental requirement. The second principle is that your documents have to be clear and unambiguous. Okay, what does that mean? Well, that means, according to case law, that the award criteria must be formulated in such a way as to allow all rewind to interpret it in the same way. Mr. Justice Kjørgen in the Gaswise case told us, and I read because it's very clear what he says, the principle of transparency implies that all the conditions and the detailed rules of the award procedure must be drawn in a clear, precise and unequivocal manner in the notice of in the contract document, so that two things: the rewind can understand the exact significance and interpret them in the same way, and that the contracting authority, i.e. you, that is the second point, are able to ascertain what is that they satisfy your criteria. It's one thing to ask them to do something, it's another thing for you to be able to understand what you have asked. So that is the importance why it should be clearly written down. That is the reason why I don't like template. The third point of having to treat them in equal manner is that you must, and you're going to laugh, but you must follow your own procedure. How many times have I seen it that people do not follow their own procedure? Why? Because they don't know what their own procedures are saying, because they use templates and they don't know. But what is important is there is an extra element to this. Not only do you have to follow your own procedure, but you have to verify that the tenderers have met the criteria. It is not what I've heard in the past, oh, we know they're not telling the truth, but listen, what can we do for short of telling them to be liars? The truth is, it's not only what if, you must verify what was said. That is quite clearly stated in the EVN case. It actually said, and again, I read it so that I do not mislead you, objective and transparent evaluation of the various tenders depends on the contracting authority relying on the information and the proof provided by the tenders being able to effectively verify whether the tender submits the meet award criteria. So this verifying effectively, your tender documents must allow you to do that. The court goes further in the EVN case. If a contracting authority lays down an award criterion indicating that it neither intends nor is able to verify, then you're breaching the fundamental principle of equal treatment. An award criteria which is not accompanied by requirements which permits the information provided by the tenders to be effectively verified is contrary to the principles of EU law. Now, I told you, you must treat them in an equal manner, but you must also act as a contracting authority according to Article 18.1 in a transparent and a proportionate manner. What does that mean? Well, first of all, it means that you cannot make an irrational decision. The decision must pass the so-called Wednesbury Unreasonable Test. And the unreasonable test is the decision you make cannot be so outrageous in its defiance of logic and or acceptance of moral standards that no sensible person would, had he or she applied this question in his mind, would have arrived to it. So you would not have arrived to it if it is unreasonable. So that is exactly what you have to make sure. Act in a transparent way means no irrational decision. If you make an irrational decision, the court must quash. No conflict of interest. It was new in 2014, but more and more comes up. You need to make sure that all the people that are involved with the procurement, and not only the evaluation team, everybody that advises you, everybody that could possibly influence the procurement process, all of them would and have to make sure that they have signed a non-conflict of interest. But also you need to make sure that there is no possibility there that the conflict of interest will actually skew the competition. So when asked the question, what appropriate measures did you take to make sure that you have prevented, identified and remedied the conflict of interest, you need to be able to answer that question. Next point is that you have to have records. Records are important. When you are in public procurement, you will make decisions. Why do I limit it to this industry? Why do I have the following experts to assist me? Why do I have the following evaluation team members? Why do I not publish it? Those are all decisions that you make. You need to write them down in a public Article 84 procurement index. And if you don't do that, then you breach public procurement fundamental rules and the courts must set it aside. It is not sufficient to have a one-pager to say this is the name, this is the subject matter, and it is clear that you will have made quite a lot of decisions. The next step is reasons. It is important to give reasons. And Judge Stuart Smith, a UK judge, but I like what he said, it's very clear, stated it extremely clearly. He says, a procurement in which a contracting authority, i.e. you, in which a contracting authority cannot explain why it awarded the scores it did, fails the basic standard of transparency. In Ireland, we have the RPS case, RPS Consulting Engineering Limited versus Kildare County Council, where Mr. Justice Humphrey specifies very clearly what and how you must give reasons, and why is it that we have to give reasons? Well, not only do you breach natural justice, says Mr. Humphrey, constitutional law, European Convention of Human Rights, and EU law, for all those reasons. But what is the purpose for the reasons? Well, first of all, you enable the tenderer to understand why he or she didn't win the tender, but also to assist the court to check afterwards if anything went wrong or not. It's also good administrative decisions that have to be made, and we want to avoid administrative malpractice. So it is a deterrent if you have to give reasons, if you have to explain it. And a very important element is, and for me the most important element, is that you have to explain to the people why they didn't get it. Don't use formalistic type of reasons, which is he was better or they were better. Mr. Justice Humphrey explains that very well. Tell them up front, this is why they were better. Be very clear. To be able to do that, you obviously need to know what your rules were. To be able to do that, you need to be very clear what you were looking for. It takes time. It's a little bit frustration that might kick in when you have to do it. But that's life. You have to go through this. It is a requirement. In Sanofi, Mr. Justice McDonnell tells us that obviously the reasons that count are only the reasons you've given before litigation starts. So don't trust that lawyers will actually give it a good spin. Well, lawyers will give it a good spin, but Mr. Justice McDonnell tells us we can't look at those. It's the reason that was given at the time. And he also explains in quite great detail why reasons have to be provided. He explains also that in certain cases it might not be, it might be very straightforward to explain it, but in others it might be more difficult. So it's case dependent. But what is very important, ladies and gentlemen, very important, is that you can explain your decision and give what they call CRAST, which is your characteristics and relative advantages of the successful tenderer. CRAST you need to give. Okay, you fail, you're a fundamental breach, and then you have your case, your decision will be quashed. Manifest error, I'm not going to say too much about it. Manifest error is the evaluation team that evaluate. It might, and the court gives in a manifest error a very broad margin of discretion to you, to your evaluation team. The court realizes very well how difficult it is to evaluate tenders. It's not easy. It's very easy for me to tell you how to do it, but when you have to do it, it is quite difficult. Court knows that. Court will not try to redo your job, because if they did, they would never, and we'd have a massive backlog. That's not what they want to do. Fundamental principles, they do, because that's a breach of law. But a breach of evaluation by you give someone only 80 marks rather than 82, court will not intervene. But If explained, and that's what is said by Mr. Justice O'Donnell in word perfect, it says an error may not be apparent on the surface of the decision and may be difficult to identify and explain. But if, once understood, it is clear that it is indeed an error, then the test is satisfied for a manifest error. I'll go to the next point, ladies and gentlemen, which is the 30 days challenging period. You know it. You own a contracting a tender only has 30 days to challenge you. It's a guillotine. That's all he has. But what is new, and this is good for you, but not so good for tenders, is what Mr. Justice MacDonald has said in the Sanofi case. And in the Sanofi case, he has said you cannot go outside your statement of grounds. Now, that's quite difficult because in the statement of grounds, if 30 days is so small, so it takes at least a week to decide will we challenge this, a week to talk to a lawyer, and then another week to overcome the cost that the lawyer has going to ask for this. It's a very short period of time, but within that period of time, the statement of grounds have to be drafted. So if, as it seems to go this way with the decision of Mr. Justice MacDonald and recently in Liam O'Duncan versus Minister of Culture, Heritage and the Gaeltacht by Mr. Justice O'Regan, is that you cannot go outside the statement of claim, a statement of grounds. There is some reference that you might ask to change that statement of amend the statement, but as Mr. Justice MacDonald says, look, it more than likely won't happen because the 30-day rules is so strict. So it's a little bit tough, but it's good for you as contracting authority, reason the more, to be on this compass line, which is the rules I have set out to you before. Justice O'Regan goes a step further. Even if you have not complied with that and you have still tried to go outside the statement of claim, well, then she will punish you when it comes to costs. For example, in that case, she decided that there was the plaintiff brought in an expert to actually explain the policy, explain the industry, explain why you needed to interpret the arguments as it is. But Ms. Justice O'Regan said, I did not need to have an expert to come and tell me those things. So therefore, I will not allow you to get your costs back for that. I let you decide on that. I personally have difficulty with that decision, but that is the decision. No, ladies and gentlemen, where are we? Well, I have to give you the message, and I have given you the message. Article 18.1. You shall treat an economic operators equally and without discrimination, and you shall act in a transparent and a proportionate manner. And you need to remember that whatever you do, in the end, you will be like King Arthur and his Knights of the Round Table. You will have to cross that bridge of death. You will have to face the scary bridge keeper or the disgruntled tenderer. And if you do not answer the questions correctly, you will not go over the gorge of the eternal peril that flows under that bridge. And by magic, you will be brought to that gorge, which in your case will be litigation, which is probably even worse than King George's gorge of eternal peril. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me put it to you in a different way, and listen to the rules of the Monty Pythons.
Ask me the questions, Bridgekeeper. I am not afraid.
What is the industry concerned to the subject of the competition?
My name is Sir Lancelot of Camelot.
What have you written down in your Article 84 procurement file?
To seek the Holy Grail.
Have you complied with the fundamental principles?
Blue.
Right, off you go.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much.
That's easy! Ask me the questions, Bridgekeeper. I'm not afraid.
What is the industry concerned to the subject of the competition?
Sir Robin of Camelot.
What have you written down in your Article 84 procurement file?
Best to seek the Holy Grail.
What are the characteristics and relative advantages of the successful tenderer?
I don't know that.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your attention. I could see you were very attentive there. And I'm open now for questions. I'm sure there will be plenty of questions. And please do not hold back. Thank you.